So I just got done watching, or listening to rather, a podcast between Chris Rufo and David French. I reacted to it live on this channel. It was a debate regarding the legislation against critical race theory in public schools and state agencies, things like that. David French, in his consummate intellectualizing, is completely against the legislative bans, whereas Chris Rufo, who is a warrior and cares more about practical application than intellectualization, is obviously completely in favor of the bans. But the reason I wanted to make this video is there is an argument that is being overlooked time and time and time and time and time again when it comes to the intellectuals who are intellectualizing about critical race theory. And it is this. The state does not have constitutional protections. The Constitution is not written for the state. The Constitution is written to protect the people. Now, the greatest trick that the teachers' unions ever played was convincing average everyday Americans that public school teachers are not state employees. Of course they're state employees. They're literally paid for by our taxpayer dollars. And because public school teachers are state employees, that means when they are acting in their job as public school teachers, they do not have free speech protections. Therefore, when you are talking about so-called bans on critical race theory in the classroom, in the public school classroom, you are not infringing on civil liberties of the teachers in any way, shape, or form, because the teachers, when they are acting in their capacity as a public government-funded teacher in a government-funded school, they do not have the same constitutional protections that they would have when they are acting in an individual capacity. Now, outside of school, if they want to get out white fragility and go set up and preach on a sidewalk about anti-racism and how all white people are racist and all these things, a public school teacher can do that to their heart's content, because in that capacity, they are not acting as an agent of the state. So they can do whatever they want in their private lives. That is their business. But when they are in a government-funded school, teaching students that are compelled to go to the government-funded school, then they do not have the same free speech protections. And this has already been decided by the Supreme Court, and we're going to read about it a little bit. This is the First Amendment Encyclopedia. Now, there's a lot in here. This is regarding specifically the rights of teachers. But we're going to scroll down just a little bit. Here's what I want to look at. Public employees no longer retain free First Amendment protections for speech as part of their official duties. Teachers asserting a First Amendment violation must now clear an additional hurdle as a result of the Supreme Court's decision in Garcetti v. Calabasas. In Garcetti, the court ruled that public employees do not retain First Amendment protections for speech as part of their official job duties. So in this debate that I listened to with David French and Chris Rufo's, David French's position is that you are inhibiting academic freedom and free speech when you ban critical race theory in public schools. Well, that's false for two reasons. Number one, I hate to break the news to David French, who maybe hasn't been involved in like K-12 public schools for a while, but there's no academic inquiry going on in K-12 public schools. There is a group of impressionable students who are required to be in the school, required to be sitting in that classroom, compelled by the state to do it, and they are being taught by teachers who are being paid a government salary to teach them. There's no research going on. There's no academic inquiry. And in fact, one thing that is never discussed is the fact that this is a population of people whose brain is not fully developed. So the logic, reason, function of our brain doesn't fully develop until we're in our early to mid-20s. So we're talking about a population who literally does not have what they need in order to use logic and reason to question what their teachers are telling them. This is part of the reason that the critical race theorists are trying to push critical race theory earlier and earlier and earlier and earlier and earlier and earlier into a child's education, because the children do not have the brain capacity to question it. And really, they don't even develop that until they're in their early to mid-20s, which has a whole other degree of implications that we're not going to go into here. So number one, academic inquiry, there's no academic freedom that is being impinged when we're talking about putting restrictions on the state for what the state can teach in schools. Okay, so that's completely false. Number two, we are talking about state employees. We need to just start referring to teachers as state employees, because when they are acting in their capacity as public school teachers, that's what they are. And that means they don't have the right to privacy in that capacity. They also don't have the right to free speech in that capacity. There are many restrictions put on public school teachers for what they can and cannot teach in the public government-funded school classroom. And so when we're talking about a ban on divisive concepts or critical race theory, that is building off of existing law that already exists to apply it in a different way. The question remains whether Garcetti should apply in an academic setting, whereas academic freedom introduces another level of constitutional concern. The majority acknowledged this distinction in stating there is some argument that expression related to academic scholarship or classroom instruction implicates additional constitutional interests that are not fully accounted for in the court's customary employee speech jurisprudence. Commentator Karen Daly notes that academic freedom is an ill-defined concept, especially when imported from university campus to secondary and elementary schools. See, this is what I'm saying right here. Academic freedom is an ill-defined concept, especially when imported from the university campus to the primary and secondary schools. Chris Rufo made a great point in this debate where he said it is actually more important for us to protect the K through 12 schools than it is the university, because university is an optional choice. You are not required to go to college, but you are required to complete K through 12 school or some derivation thereof, and 90% of the students in schools today are in public government-funded schools in which they are compelled to be at. So, several lower courts have applied the Garcetti ruling broadly to limit teacher classroom speech. For example, the 7th U.S. Circuit of Appeals ruled in Brown v. Chicago Board of Education that public school teacher did not have a First Amendment claim when his principal disciplined him for using the N-word, as well as a well-intentioned lecture instructing students about not using racial slurs. Because of Garcetti, Brown's First Amendment claims fail right out of the gate, the appeals court wrote. So this is already saying that we absolutely 100% can restrict the speech of public school teachers, because when they are acting in their capacity as public school teachers, they are acting on behalf of the state. And because they are acting on behalf of the state, they do not have the same types of constitutional protections that they would have if they were acting as individuals. This is something that is just routinely overlooked in these arguments. It is already established law. The Supreme Court has established it, and though they may do some clarification in the future, it still seems as though right now, this is pretty cut and dry, folks. If you get paid by our tax dollars, then you are an employee of the state. You do not have the same right to free speech, and that's why we can implement critical race theory bans in K through 12 classrooms. I mean, I'm sure there are going to be lawsuits about colleges sooner or later, but K through 12, this is pretty clear. They're already doing it in other areas, and any intellectual who's out there intellectualizing and saying anything else simply hasn't read the Garcetti case to know that this is already established law. All right, guys, that's all I've got for this one. Hey, if you want to support the work I'm doing, the very best thing you can do is join my Locals community, kb.locals.com. Locals is free to join. You get all my videos ad-free in the process. But if you really want to support me and get access to all the features and all the perks, including our 2 Zoom calls a week, our book club, our debate club, being able to comment on all the posts, it costs $5 a month or $50 a year. So you can do it on a monthly basis, $5 a month. Or if you want to save a couple of months, just sign up for the $50 a year. If you're really hard up for cash, just get in touch with me. I'll provide you with a promo code. I want everyone to be in Locals because it is the only sane place on the internet. And I don't want that $5 to be the reason that you're not there if you really want to be there. Now, if you're just a little troll, I'm going to boot you out real quick. But if you really want to be there, you really want to be interacting with the community, just reach out to me if you don't have the cash, man. I try to be a reasonable person. All right, guys, that's all I've got. I'll see you soon.